İyi akşamlar. I have to warn you. Attending an event like this can be dangerous. Because it was an event like this in 2006 that I first heard the name Fethullah Gulen. It was an iftar dinner at the Sheraton Hotel in downtown Philadelphia. I had been invited by an organization called the Dialogue Forum. I had no idea who the Dialogue Forum was. And they invited me to a free dinner, and I liked the idea of a free dinner, so I said, okay, I will go. The speaker that night was a man by the name of Tom Michel, who was at the time the chair of the Vatican's Interreligious Affairs Office. Thank you.
In coming years, summer camps became regular features for both boys and girls of Hizmet. Salah in the camp or mosque by men or women is a physical process that follows a step-by-step practice. Gulen himself put it this way, and a couple more paragraphs. Gulen told the Prophet how to pray. These are his words, and we are told to follow his example. There are certain rules to follow. Before beginning, we must purify ourselves with the proper ablution, wudu. Then we say Allahu Akbar, meaning that nothing is greater than God. Standing in a peaceful, respectful stillness with hands joined together on our chest indicates our complete surrender. Concentrating as fully and deeply as possible allows us to experience the Prophet's ascension in our spirit. Rising up inwardly, we bow down physically to renew our surrender and express our humility. As we do so, we experience a different stage in our servanthood and so prostrate in fuller reverence and humility. Now, end quote. What is vital to recognize here again is the non-violence and even anti-violence inherent in this practice. A humble person is a peaceful person. Nobody could kill another while bowing down to God. Indeed, at the end of public prayer, after the series of prescribed postures and practices, the supplicant turns to right and then left and says, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Peace and mercy of God be with you. Of course, as with most ritual, repetition is part of the point. The brain changes slowly but surely from its animal habits of fight or flight into something recognizably human through habits of patient practice like repeated prayer. It helps to be in a community of practice, which is the idea behind every assembly, Jewish, Christian, Muslim, or otherwise. Gulen put it this way, quote, Salah is when patience is put into practice. It is also the most propitious and appropriate ground for social agreement and harmony and the greatest sign of the formation of a Muslim community. Everyone who is able to make belief a part of their nature through Salah and dive into the depths of the life of the heart through it and see themselves as an inseparable part of a community like a firm, solid structure in its warm and peaceful climate. He's thinking of Istanbul rather than Ottawa, maybe, in winter. I'm sorry, bad joke. Anyone who experiences that can easily overcome the hardships along the path of servanthood, end quote. So prayer, in addition to bringing personal peace, could bring a community of peace. That was Gulen's wager in reviving the practice of prayer. And of course, commentary here, he also sought to revive practice of the other four pillars of the faith, fasting during Ramadan, pilgrimage to Hajj, if you are able to make the pilgrimage, the practice of zakat, charity, in the particular form of himet, for Hizmet, supporting himet for Hizmet, yes, right? And then finally, of course, also the declaration of faith, the shahada, which again is inherently non-violent in its affirmation. So the altruism of non-violence, altruism without borders. Third, the altruism of engaged empathy. And here a long story
From one of the interviews that I did, this was an interview in Izmir with Latin Kirkan, who was a tailor. It was through Hovhaç Efendi's tears that people grew closer to Islam, Mr. Kirkan asserted. Kirkan told the story of a conversion that could have been repeated in many variants across Turkey in the 1970s. This is page 138 and 139 if you're interested in following along, right at the bottom. Gülen was preaching an Eid sermon, Kirkan recalled. Eid is the name of the two major Islamic festivals, one at the end of Ramadan, the other during Hajj. The location was Hisar Mosque in Izmir, a 16th century beauty at the heart of the city. Kirkan had invited a customer who had never prayed in his life. The customer was scared. It was his first time in a mosque. Kirkan's rich story continues, and I quote from him at length. Hoca Efendi was at the kürsü, the pulpit. My friend was behind me in the second row. When Hoca Efendi started to explain about an early Muslim conflict, there was a cry from the rear side of the mosque. My friend touched my shoulder and said, "This one in the rear must be a mystic." In the presence of Hoca Efendi, we wouldn't ordinarily move, but I touched my friend's knee, meaning I understood. But then someone from our left side started crying as well. Then my friend touched my shoulder and said, "There's another holy one." But the lesson was so wonderful that during the sermon, there was nobody who was not crying. Even my friend was crying. At the climax of the sermon, Hoca Efendi was telling the story about our mother Sumaira, one of the companions of the Prophet. As Gülen rated the story, Sumaira had told her father, husband, and two sons to not come back from the war if something happened to the Prophet. And then she heard war news that our Prophet was a martyr. She got on her horse, went to the battlefield. There was a man lying on the ground almost dead. Someone said, "Sumaira, this is your father." She said, "Forget about my father. Where's the Prophet?" They showed her husband as well. And she said, "This isn't time for father or husband. Where's the Prophet?" Then they pointed to her boys who were mortally wounded. She said again, "Where's the Prophet?" After this one of the companions told Sumaira, "What's your worry? He's right there in the front." And then she got off her course. Her horse came close to the Prophet and kissed the ground. She said, "I have found you. Let time stop. Let creation stop." While he was telling us this story, Hoca Efendi beat his breast and said, "Ah, if this heart would stop, this heart would stop." Then he bowed down and cried for minutes. That's when I turned around and saw my friend crying as well. Well, when we were getting out of the mosque, I put my arm around my friend and asked him, "So, are you one of those holy ones as well?" And he said, "This is such a hoja. Not only does he cry, he makes everyone else cry." From that day on, the friend of mine who was saved by that sermon became a person who cried his whole life. End quote. Here, crying one's whole life was a metaphor for the gurba that Sufism taught and that Gülen practiced. The lesson of this particular sermon, after all, was a difficult one. Love for the Prophet might even be more profound than love of one's marital partner or father or son. Such love has brought many to tears. Now, I'm going to jump ahead a little bit to the bottom of page. It would be a mistake, though, to presume that it was only emotion that drew people to Gülen's preaching. And it was surely more than emotion that kept people connected to the growing Hizmet movement. Institutions do not get built on empathy alone. Instead, what emerges from the reports of those who listened to Guillen's sermons during his years around the Aegean is that he promoted a balance between profound emotion and pragmatic action. Call it engaged empathy. Guillen's tears signified the suffering of Muslims. But his preaching also gave Muslims a positive way out of suffering through concrete action on behalf of greater justice and peace. Ghorba became hope through Hizmet. So the example of engaged empathy is an example of what Mr. Guillen frequently emphasized, namely that we must fly, not with one wing, but with two wings. Flying with two wings, empathy, emotion, and yet engaged in practical action. The altruism of engaged empathy. Fourth, the altruism of Hosh Goru. Forgive my pronunciation again. And here, what is best known about Mr. Guillen and the people of Hizmet would be the dialogue events held in the 1990s in Istanbul. Dialogue events sponsored by the Journalists and Writers Foundation that brought together thousands of people of all varieties across Istanbul. I mean, truly unprecedented inter-religious gatherings in the history of Turkey, and in many ways, cutting-edge events in the history of religions around the globe as well. But what fascinated me about Mr. Guillen's teaching of Hosh Goru is that he made these advances by going back to the teachings of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So, on page 235, here's how I describe what he drew in part out of the teachings of the Prophet. If his sermons on the Prophet's Hosh Goru bound Muslims together in trust, it's a very important word, right? Trust, just crucial as the glue that held people to Mr. Guillen and held people together in friendships within Hizmet. What was perhaps most startling about Mr. Guillen's sermons is how they also subtly harnessed what is called bridging social capital. So social capital is, you know, what holds movements and organizations together. And there are two different kinds. There's bonding social capital, that which builds trust on the inside of an organization. And then there's bridging social capital, which builds on relationships to develop partnerships with others and to reach out to others. Guillen's interpretation of the Prophet's life impelled Muslims to try to forge new and more just and peaceful relations with their neighbors. They did so neither out of ideological allegiance to a Western project, as Ataturk had, of course, attempted, and as we heard earlier, nor out of duplicitous lip service to human rights embedded in a neoliberal economic plan, as more recent leaders in Turkey have attempted. Rather, Guillen's project to persuade Turkish Muslims to live lives of Hizmet grew organically out of his interpretation of the life of Muhammad. That it succeeded almost as rapidly as Islam itself, this is important to know, that it succeeded so rapidly says something important about how religion might be a foundation for peace building around the globe. The kinds of initiatives that Guillen proposed bore many, if not most, of the hallmarks of classical progressive social change. Religious freedom, respect for diversity, equality for women, and ending racism. But they were forged on an undeniably Islamic foundation. It's crucial to recall that Istanbul was the context for most of these sermons. The boy from Erzurum was now on Turkey's largest stage. And the city, that's what Istanbul was known as, the city, had attained its lofty status not through some narrow interpretation of Islam, Guillen preached. Instead, Istanbul under the Ottomans had embraced the Prophet's own Hosh Goru. And the Prophet's Hosh Goru included religious freedom and diversity. Naturally, Guillen made clear, Muhammad wanted all people to be Muslims, and he did his best to persuade them to do so. But the Prophet was also respectful of difference, Guillen stressed. The prophet sought to respect especially Jews and Christians, the people of the book. It is fascinating to see how Guillen subtly invited his listeners to recognize the broad and deep relationships between Muslims and Jews. He did this in a context when, for some Muslims, under the influence of Wahhabi, Salafi rigorism, and Iranian revolutionary zeal, both Jews and Christians were infidels. And yet, from the most foundational Islamic sources,
from the Quran and the Sunnah, Guillen identified an unmistakable and irrefutable common lineage of prophets who came before Muhammad that linked Muhammad to both Jewish and Christian forebears. Quote, "A companion must ask God's messenger to talk about himself," Guillen introduced the matter. Quote, he said, "I am the one for whose coming Abraham prayed and of whom Jesus gave glad tidings," end quote. Now, Guillen here argued that Muhammad was anticipated in both the Torah and Gospels, that bit of exegesis most Christian and Jewish scholars would have some trouble accepting. But in the context of his preaching, Guillen's effort conveyed a matter far more serious than some literal correspondence between text and historical causality. Guillen sought to clarify the point, as he put it in another of his publications, that, quote, "More than anything else, the pride of humankind," that is the prophet, "gave value to every human being, regardless of whether that person was a Muslim, Christian, or Jew." So the altruism of Hosh Goru, which usually gets translated in English into tolerance, which is actually a terrible translation of the word. The word literally means, you know, to see nicely, right? But even that, it's hard to kind of comprehend. So I talk about Hosh Goru, and this is my academic term for it. It's principled pluralism. That is, you know who you are, you know where you stand when you're seeing another, but you respect them. You give them what Rabbi Jonathan Sacks calls the dignity of difference. All right? And I heard Dr. Scott Alexander, who's a professor at Catholic Theological Union, I believe, in Chicago, say the best definition of Hosh Goru is actually a theological definition. And I think this is where Hoja Effendi is coming from, which is Hosh Goru is to see another as God sees them. And that means centrally to see another with eyes of mercy and compassion, as we pray, Bismillah al-Rahman al-Rahim. We pray in the name of God, the most merciful, the most compassionate. And that's Hosh Goru in practice, to see another, altruism, as God sees them. Two more. You still with me? Okay. The altruism then of Istishara. Page 288. On one level, Guillen's story gets rather simple to tell after 1999. So you'll note the book moves through his life, from his time in Korjuk and Erzurum to his service in Edirne, and then to Izmir, to Istanbul, and finally to America in 1999. So the five chapters follow his life chronologically and geographically as well. They also each have a theme, and the brochure, beautiful job with the brochure, by the way. Thank you for that. It's very nicely done, with the exception of the picture on the front, which, you know, we could have easily lost. Should have put a picture of the book, but anyway, thank you for that. It really is lovely. It's beautifully done. So his story becomes rather simple to tell after 1999. Once he arrived in America, Hoja Effendi almost never left the 25-acre Golden Generation Retreat Center located in the foothills of the Pocono Mountains in Sailorsburg, Pennsylvania. How many, just out of curiosity, have been there? Okay, good number. Okay, so you've been to Pennsylvania. I hope you don't have that stamped on your visa. Could be dangerous. I shouldn't joke about it. But we must laugh or we'll cry, right? In newspapers, the center is almost invariably characterized as a compound. A compound.
Such characterization is inaccurate. There's a guardhouse and gate where one individual monitors the driveway that leads from the narrow rural highway to the main buildings, of which there are two. One is a three-story structure that houses a dining hall on its first floor with a large meeting room on the second floor and a third floor where Gulen's room is located. These accommodations are similar in their simplicity to Hoca Efendi's apartment in Istanbul. Gulen lives, by and large, in two very modest rooms. One a sitting room and study, the other his bedroom. That's it. Compare that, by way of contrast, with the presidential palace. Which one? Yeah, he's got a summer palace now too, right? I mean, really. If you want to understand the ethical contrast between these two individuals, just look at where they live, at how they choose to use God's gifts and resources. One, letting go of them in service to others, to inspire others, living modestly, simply, never marrying. The other, living in ostentation and obvious greed and gluttony. Could I be clearer? I suspect I'm preaching to the choir on this, as you say. But the second main building on the campus is a three-story multi-purpose prayer center, meeting space, and dormitory. It's not unlike the dormitories that his participants built in Turkey and around the world. There are eight other homes on the perimeter of the gardens. They house guests, students, and other staff members live nearby in private homes with their families. The rest of the land is dedicated to gardens, a playground, walking trails, a small pond, and parking lots. All development has happened gradually over the years. It's a modest park-like retreat center, decidedly absent the militarized features that the word compound conjures. Words matter. How we describe things matters. And journalists repeat this over and over and over again, that, you know, there is the shadowy Muslim cleric living in a compound in Pennsylvania. No, he's living in like a YMCA camp, right? I mean, let's be honest and clear about what we're talking about. So if on one Gulen's life level, Gulen's life story becomes rather simple to tell after settling into this comfortable place of retreat, on another level, Gulen's story gets more difficult to document after 1999. Lacking retroactive access to a Hizmet Google calendar that does not, to my knowledge, exist, it is impossible to be sure about exactly what Gulen did in the quotidian moments of his years in Sailorsburg. And this is one of the things that became apparent to me as I wrote this biography. It's really an impossible task. Because every life is so infinitely complex, made up of relationships with so many people over the course of any day, constituted by so many feelings and thoughts and ideas. Try encompassing just a single day of your life in a book and it's nearly impossible, right? So anyway, just a caution there that this was a far more difficult task than I expected it to be when I undertook it on many levels. What we do have are the public results, and especially the hundreds of organizations that had some connection to people of Hizmet. Perhaps some intrepid future historian will be able to work back from those results and find their origins in Pennsylvania. For while he was living in semi-seclusion, Gulen was also welcoming guests on a regular basis and communicating with others occasionally. Most of the communication was one way only from Gulen to those inspired by him. For instance, Gulen began having his weekly sermons posted and eventually streamed on the internet, and he also wrote for a wide variety of publications when they existed, such as Zaman, Sazinta, and so forth. Regarding personal communication, he favored old-school face-to-face meetings. When guests would visit, most stayed briefly a day or two, some stayed longer for weeks, most stayed, some chose to reside nearby. Any guest who had reason to conduct business with Gulen had opportunity to witness his distinctive mode of organizational practice, and this is what is intriguing to me. It was known as istishara, or occasionally as shura. These Arabic terms can be translated as seeking advice or mutual consultation. When not praying or in individual supplication, when not teaching students, reading, writing, educating, or watching TV, almost exclusively news, then Fethullah Gulen in America was likely engaged in consultation. The types and frequency of the consultations varied from day to day. They could be dictated by Gulen's increasingly frail health, One day, Abis or Ablas would come to seek his opinion about opening a school in the Far East. Another day, Turkish businessmen would ask questions about a new venture in Africa. And on the third day, his health would not permit him to meet with anyone. But after prayer and teaching, consultation was a regular part of Hoja Effendi's life in America. We have records from only a few of these consultations from the years between 1999 and 2018. But if details of each meeting evade us, and no doubt would be interesting to conspiracy theorists, we can document consistent ways that Gulen interacted with people seeking his counsel. We can call it the Istishara script. He did not follow it slavishly. And people would interpret what Gulen said in a consultation. A no to one person might be a yes to another. The Istishara process was organic. It often produced debate. Sometimes when a group thought was one decision would lead to a return visit for more consultation. But in these meetings, Gulen generally would listen more than speak. By listening, Gulen indicated that this was a meeting between equals. When he would offer his insight, it would often be couched in a phrase that began with the word Estağfurullah. Is that okay? Could you understand that? Somebody say it loudly for me. Estağfurullah. Okay, not too bad. This complex Turkish term can only be translated into a complete English sentence. I ask God's forgiveness with the additional connotation of, who am I to answer your question since all knowledge is with God? It would seem to be an odd way to offer advice. And it certainly nods to Mr. Gulen's modesty. But note well, the core of that sentence is simply, I ask. So Gulen would in some meetings ask individuals to undertake initiatives or to take established projects in new directions. Depending upon how well the person seeking Gulen's counsel knew Hoca Efendi, a mere hint was often enough. In many cases, Gulen knew that the initiatives he was asking them to undertake could cost his friends in terms of time, comfort, and or financial resources, hence the need to ask for God's forgiveness. But while these asks were couched in a theological context that lent them gravity, they also turned the initiative over to the individuals themselves. This was apparent in the second line of Fethullah Gulen's Istishara script. That line was in Turkish, Siz bilirsiniz. You know best. Depending upon the context, the inflection in his voice, and other subtle cues, this could be Gulen's gentle way of saying, no. But more often, it was in socio-psychological jargon, Gulen's way of empowering individuals to exercise their agency. Journalist Karim Balcha put it well, if a bit anachronistically. Hoca Efendi came as the first Obama. He said, we can. He gave us self-confidence. People who came to Gulen in America brought with them not only proposals, they brought skills. Gulen expected them to use those skills. So although nobody kept minutes at these consultations, and thus the details of the deliberations are not available to us other than anecdotally, what is completely clear are the results. Istishara multiplied organizations around the world. And then those individuals who met with Gulen at his retreat center took Istishara with them as a model to the schools, dialogue centers, and other businesses around the globe. Hizmet-related activities and businesses were all managed more or less in accord with the Istishara model. And the import for the historical record of this Istishara model is that Fethullah Gulen was hardly a micromanaging CEO, much less a puppet master who manipulated cult devotees.
Quite simply, Fethullah Gulen taught people how to apply a central Islamic principle to community organizing and business processes. He started things or encouraged them, and then let people use their skills to run them. And one of the areas of organization that became increasingly important to Gulen's time in America was humanitarian relief work. He had always paid attention to human suffering in his teaching. Gulen frequently quoted Said Nursi to the effect that there were three interrelated problems plaguing the world: ignorance, destructive conflict, and poverty. Ignorance can be defeated through education, Gulen taught. Conflict, Gulen believed, could be overcome through dialogue and tolerance. Hush, Guru. But it was the problem of poverty that occupied especially the latter years of Gulen's life and the activities of people of his met after 1999. Poverty could be defeated, Gulen contended, again following Nursi, through work and the possession of capital. By work, Gulen did not mean to imply that poverty was a result of laziness. Rather, Gulen stressed, along with many sociologists and economists, that employment dignified human living, especially when it was matched with the living wage as the reward for diligent labor. And capital was not to be possessed for its own end of accumulation. Capital also should serve greater goods, notably education and conflict resolution.
And it did so through organizations to be decided upon, of course, through consultation. So Fethullah Gulen taught and practiced capitalism with a difference. He emphatically did not embrace the greed is good approach associated with unfettered free markets. There, in what Muhammad Yunus has identified as profit-maximizing organizations, the quarterly profit of shareholders mattered more than the long-term interests of stakeholders. Gulen's organizational approach was both broader and more focused. Naturally, he hoped that people would develop sustainable ventures that continued to generate wealth, to thereby alleviate poverty, educate people, and promote dialogue. But he was not an economist or business leader himself. His teaching about how to alleviate poverty was never simply a set of economic arrangements. He was always a Muslim preacher and theologian. His teaching about how to alleviate poverty was always couched within a theological context. The maxim, as Gulen developed it, was akin to the teachings of Christian liberation theologians, and here's the key phrase, being with the oppressed is the same as being with God. The altruism of istishara. And finally, and I'll close with this, the altruism beyond time and space. And these are the last pages of the biography. So 357 to the end. In one of his many speeches to friends, as troubles began to escalate in Turkey, Fethullah Gulen interpreted a famous Quranic passage that reads, "Whatever good happens to you, it is from God, and whatever evil befalls you, it is from yourself." According to Gulen, what this passage pointed to is that, quote, "we may not always see clearly the underlying reasons behind events," end quote. In such cases, of which the current oppression of people of Hizmet surely was one, it was wisest to turn inwards towards self-criticism and to turn always toward forgiveness from God. Quote, "blaming oneself for troubles and misfortunes depends on a consciousness of serious self-criticism." These are Mr. Gulen's words. "This in turn depends on a sound faith in God and the day of judgment." Gulen's perspective throughout his life, again, had been consistently kept on a horizon of eternity, that horizon of eternity kept before believers' eyes, altruism beyond time and space. But, he went on, even better than any post-trouble turn towards self-criticism was patient striving on the path of goodness. Quote, "I wish that instead of struggling to restore their hearts and spiritual lives, people could build up barriers against their destruction from the very beginning. For it is very difficult to restore something after it has been destroyed," end quote. There were those within Hizmet who scrutinized their own behavior and relationships in the wake of events in Turkey after 2010, just as there were others who persevered in patient work as teachers, dialogue activists, and social entrepreneurs. But these practices were nothing new for them. And no matter how they responded to their oppression in Turkey, Gulen and many people of Hizmet knew that their hope for a restored Turkish democracy had dim probability of being realized by almost any reckoning of short-term history. Gulen reserved a plot in a cemetery in Pennsylvania, expecting never to return to Turkey again. And yet, he kept hope nonetheless. This, too, was nothing new for Gulen and for many within Hizmet. Finding hope in the midst of trouble had been a regular, almost routine part of his biography. And by now there were islands of peace, as he called them, on every continent. Those peace islands were the schools, dialogue centers, and social enterprises wherever they operated. And those peace islands were countries where new friends could be made and where Muslims could practice their faith without oppression. For if an old man might be tempted during a cold winter in exile to despair of ever again seeing those green spring days, as Gulen wrote in a poem while in America, he also wrote, "Eyes again on a very long horizon and tied to no specific nation." And these are now Hoxha Effendi's words. "Our old world will experience an amazing springtime before its demise. This springtime will see the gap between rich and poor narrow. The world's riches will be distributed more justly according to work, capital, and needs. There will be no discrimination based on race, color, language, or worldview. And basic human rights and freedoms will be protected. Individuals will come to the fore, and learning how to realize their potential will ascend on the way to becoming the most elevated human on the wings of love, knowledge, and belief. In this new springtime, when scientific and technological progress has been taken into consideration, people will understand that the current level of science and technology resembles the stage when an infant is just learning to crawl. Humanity will organize trips into space as if they were merely traveling to another country. Travelers on the way to God, those devotees of love who have no time for hostility, will carry their inspirations within their spirits to other worlds. Yes, this springtime will arise on the foundations of love, compassion, mercy, dialogue, acceptance of others, mutual respect, justice, and rights. It will be a time in which humanity will discover its real essence. Goodness and kindness, righteousness and virtue will form the basic essence of the world. No matter what happens, the world will come to this path sooner or later. Nobody can prevent this. We pray and beg that the infinitely compassionate one will not let our hopes and expectations come to nothing." End quote. Now, in a winter of brutal strongmen, such hopes for a glorious spring seemed utopian, no better than a prayer. Yet if there was one thing that Fethullah Gulen really knew how to do, it was to pray. So when he also encouraged people that difficulties increase in accordance with the greatness of the consequent reward, once again, difficulties increase in accordance with the greatness of the consequent reward, that too was a prayer. But it was also a maxim that had been tested in Fethullah Gulen's life and proven true, almost from its beginning. To some, the oppression in Turkey signaled the death of Gulen's dream for a golden generation. And there was surely a death looming. The boy from Korucuk was now a frail old man. And yet Fethullah Gulen's life was never about a short-term horizon to be measured by the brief span of 80 years. He believed in heaven, he believed in resurrection, he believed in justice. These beliefs were not tied only to the next news cycle, the next election cycle, or even to an individual life cycle. His horizon was eternal. And if the moral arc of the universe was long, and it seemed particularly long in the second decade of the 21st century, Gulen and people close to him also shared the belief of many people of faith that the moral arc of the universe did bend toward justice. They also were convinced that it was humanity's duty to help bend the moral arc of the universe in that direction. As Gulen put it often in many publications, power resides in truth. Power resides in truth. Any power otherwise founded was destined to fail. And so the end of Fethullah Gulen's earthly life, whenever it would happen, would hardly be the end of Hizmet. Eternal truth could not be contained by an authoritarian's ambitions. Fethullah Gulen had lived for a peace that surpassed understanding, because it was a peace that surpassed the superficial limits of time and space. After all, even a Sufi in exile, whirled in a light far more substantial than mere earthly matter, caught up in an energy that was present at the very beginning of creation, and that would be there at the end of time. Thank you very much for your patience.